cannabis.com/advertise if you're interested. And if you're a listener out there and you just want to help us continue our operations, you can become a VIP member, a supporting member of 420 Radio. Just visit 420radio.org/VIP, sign up for a monthly donation, or just make a one-time donation if you can. All that helps us to cover more of these events and bring more of these excellent presentations to you from some of the top experts in marijuana law reform. Speaking of which, we are going to go now back to the International Cannabis Business Conference, and we've got this great presentation from Kendra Miller. She's with the Normal Women's Alliance, and she's also a cannabis attorney. So check this out.
Right and wrong way of accepting money. There's a right and wrong way to accept money for your business, and there's a right and wrong way to give money to a potential business. But before I begin, I want to go over some basic terms to make sure that we're all on the same page here. Private equity is the first term. And in the private equity realm, what you have are investors giving money directly to private companies, okay? These private equity investments are not available on any type of public exchange. And when I say public exchange, I mean NASDAQ or DAO. The next term I want to define is private equity investor. A private equity investor is one who purchases interest in private companies, usually in exchange for money, or it could also be for services. A private equity investor shares in the risks and rewards of their investment in the company. For example, if the company is financially successful, then the investor is entitled to receive a return on his or her investment plus any additional revenue based on their pro rata share ownership in the company. But if the company loses money, then the private equity investor risks losing their entire investment. Okay. Last term, loan. There are two basic types of loans. There's secured and an unsecured loan. A secured loan is backed or supported by collateral, and an unsecured loan is the exact opposite. A credit card is a common example of an unsecured loan. Okay, now California law. There are two basic ways in which you can cultivate and distribute medical marijuana to your patients in the state of California. And that is if you are a collective or a cooperative. A collective is a group of people coming together. Oh, stepped away from the mic. A collective is a group of people coming together for a common purpose. In this case, to cultivate marijuana to medical marijuana patients. A collective and a cooperative is jointly owned and operated by their members for their common purpose. A cooperative, on the other hand,
take this.
Oh, yeah, please. It's a little restricted. There. Take off the chains. Okay. A cooperative is an actual corporation where you file articles of organization with the Secretary of State. So a cooperative is a separate legal person under the law that can sue and be sued. Okay, now whether you are a collective or a cooperative, the purpose of your organization shall be the following, and I'm just going to read directly from the language that I use in my bylaws, so excuse me while I look down. A collective shall operate as a not-for-profit, collective or cooperative, democratically controlled, and not organized to make a profit for itself or for its members, but primarily for its members as patrons. The earnings and savings of the corporation must be used for the mutual benefit of its members or equitably distributed to the members in the form of cash, property, credits, or services. Okay, that's a mouthful. Let's break it down. Not-for-profit. Now, Henry Witkowski will be able to go into greater details on the not-for-profit rules. I am just going to give you broad brushstrokes. Okay. Not-for-profit. So the corporation can't be organized for the purpose of making a profit. That's very important to understand. If you are cultivating and distributing cannabis to medical patients in this state. So what this means, essentially, at the end of your fiscal year, your books have to zero balance, okay? And if there's anything that's deemed profit, it must be equitably distributed to all of your patient members in the form of cash, property, credits, or services. Okay, so Now that we know we're in California and we have a medical marijuana business, we have to either be a collective or a cooperative. The question becomes, Kendra, how do I finance my business? How do I get money to continue or grow or expand my business activities? Well, the first option is a loan. You can get a loan from someone, essentially asking someone to act like a bank, to lend the business money. Now, as I said before, there are two basic types of loans, the secured loan and the unsecured loan. You should have an idea before you approach a lender of what type of loan you're looking for. And if you are looking for a secured loan, then make sure it's very clear what the collateral is that you're putting up to back that loan. Now, there's a couple of things to remember when you're entering into the realm of talking to lenders. One, please understand that a loan has to be repaid whether or not the business does well. So if the business completely fails, you're still on the hook for that loan. Which is why when you're looking at the different types of financing, two basic forms, equity financing and lender financing, most small business owners veer towards the equity financing. Why is that? Because if for some reason the business doesn't do well, the equity investor shares in the risks and rewards of that investment. If the business does well or does not do well, the lender doesn't care because they want their money back anyway. Okay.
And now, a message from former President George W. Bush to remind the American people of our responsibility in our nation's war on certain American substances, non-pharmaceutical, non-alcoholic, tobacco-free drugs.
One major responsibility is to encourage people to use less drugs.
That's right, America, use less drugs. Put down the Prozac, the Vioxx, and the Levitra, and turn to the herb. Use less drugs. Our national policy is no longer just say no. It's now just slow down.
You get me too high. I overanalyze. If you've ever been too high, then you can sympathize. You get me too high. And I start to fly if I said some silly thing, and that's the reason why.
You can get 420 Radio on the go with the Ustream video app for Android and iPhone. Go to rad-r.us/420Ustream or just click the Ustream app icon for Android or iPhone below the live radio feed at 420radio.org.
This is Radical Russ encouraging you to take a look at the Weed Blog every day. Johnny Green and the staff at the Weed Blog are on top of all the latest developments in the fight to end marijuana prohibition nationwide. You can even get the Weed Blog on your smartphone by installing the Weed Blog app for iPhone and Android. If it's about weed, it's on the Weed Blog, including my original writing. So don't delay. Read the Weed Blog today.
Fun.
Oh, hello, I'm Big Daddy, and I want you to join me at the Funky Roller Ring. We're partying hard over here, baby, so stop on by, check out the funky grooves, and shake your booty, too.
Don't get in a two-piece, brother, don't get in a two-heavy, don't get so you can move a bottle whenever you get ready.
Oregon has joined Washington and Colorado in legalizing marijuana. We're Portland Normal, the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws chapter in Portland, Oregon. Join us as we celebrate the launch of an exciting new era in marijuana freedom in Oregon. Our job has just begun. Powerful interests want to white out the most important portions of Oregon's legalization law. By joining Portland Normal, you add your voice to the thousands who voted for Measure 91 and want it to be implemented as written. The people have spoken. Now it is time for the legislature to obey the will of the people. Find out more about Portland Normal at portlandnormal.org. Attend our monthly membership meetings on the fourth Saturday of the month. See our website for more details. Portland Normal, ensuring responsible adult marijuana consumers are afforded the same rights, privileges, and responsibilities as beer drinkers.
Ladies, he said that. Not
I
me.
Did say that, and I mean that.
Welcome back, everybody. We got Scott Jordan here from Dynamic Funding Inc. and done deals in 2014. We're going to talk a little bit about getting your business, your cannabis business, funded. Welcome back, Scott. We met back in Denver, right?
We did. Thank you so much on 420 in that wonderful Cannabis Cup environment there. That was a lot of fun. Hope to see you back there this year.
Oh,
as well,
I'll be
brother.
There. In fact, I might even be a judge this year, so I might be there for a long time.
Oh, you lucky guy, man.
You know, the perks of the job. I got.
Oh, God.
Now, when we first met, you were just getting cranked up with this, and now you've got some better information to tell us. So let's get into it.
Great.
What's new for 2015?
Great. Well, we've just completed a very, very exciting 2014. We completed $6 million worth of debt financing for four different companies, starting right after Cannabis Cup. I met several dispensary owners there that we were able to get the money that they need. Several of them are under non-disclosure, but probably the largest one we've done is we did a $2 million semi-secured loan with a one-year term for a dispensary owner that went from four shops to eight shops and then got four licenses in Aurora, needed additional money last month. We gave them another $1.3 million that is not secured by any specific assets, just a general UCC lien. We've been very, very aggressive in figuring out how to work with both the MED and the business owners to get them the cash that they need without having to give up ownership. You know, many business owners want to keep their whole baby in place and not give away an arm, a leg, you know, an ear to someone that, you know, they don't know. And what I'm seeing is a building momentum for this particular business is probably going to do close to $85 million this year. With their opening of new stores, they're going to be really prime for Big Tobacco, somebody else that wants a nationwide footprint to go ahead and buy them up, and they'll be able to really reap the rewards of the hard work that they've put in for the last 4 years building this empire.
So you've been doing this work in Colorado, but of course now we've got two more states coming online, my home state of Oregon, the Great White North and Alaska. How does that improve the possibilities here as far as funding these businesses?
Sure. Well, we're very excited. I mean, there's more than enough business just in Colorado and California from what we're seeing. Oregon, I've actually had discussions with MBank about potentially providing them with some debt-based financing for their depositors. We're also talking to Fourth Corner Credit Union and some of the other banks and other financial institutions as a way to help their customers maintain the deposits and grow the deposits, because every business needs money in order to grow. There's not a business that doesn't need money, and smart businesses use leverage, you know, like the Trump organization did. He didn't buy buildings for cash. He went ahead and put down some and then leveraged the rest and used his expertise in order to make money. We want to provide debt-based financing for marijuana businesses and other businesses, but we particularly want to help those that don't have a lot of choices right now grow up in the industry.
You know, everyone's looking for big numbers when it comes to financing their business, but the other thing you have to worry about are the big letters. There's FinCEN, FDIC, SEC. What are the regulatory hurdles, and how are you clearing these and getting this financing going?
What we're doing, that's a great question. We're in compliance with the MED in Colorado in terms of extending loans to Colorado businesses. We figured out how to work through their complex system of getting debt-based deals done. We're not doing anything afoul of the laws. What we're doing is we're simply finding people that need money, connecting them up with either ourselves or one of our syndication partners to lend money, and then giving them the money and then taking the repayment. We're not taking in money, so we don't have to worry about money laundering or any of the other things that people that are ingesting money. We're simply outflowing money and then allowing that money to come back to us.
Wow, this is really amazing. Scott Jordan's with Dynamic Funding Incorporated, working to get funding for these businesses as they break out from this small mom and pop size to statewide organizations. And as you say, the future that's coming, which is the national footprint, it may take a while. As long as marijuana is federally prohibited, it might be a while before Altria wants to jump in the waters. But what's your prediction on that? What do you see this going, and how soon before the big national players get involved?
You know, that's a great question. I've been part of three revolutions in my life. The long-distance telecom revolution in 1980, I was with MCI. I was with a company called ICG that was a competitive local exchange carrier when they were breaking down the Bell systems. And then I also was with a company that did voice over the internet before people could spell VoIP.
VoIP. That's my entire radio career is dedicated because, I mean, I couldn't do my interviews without VoIP.
Exactly. VoIP has been an amazing revolutionary technology.
I used to have to pack bag after bag after bag just to do
and
what I
pay a lot of money to plug into a local signal and try to get it broadcast. Yeah, it's amazing what technology has done. And the same thing is going to happen with the cannabis industry. I feel we're about 3 to 4 years early, of course, depending on who gets elected to the next presidency. You know, that'll determine a lot of it. Hopefully, it'll be someone that's along the lines of Obama that's, you know, cannabis supportive.
Or at least not cannabis.
Oh, yeah, that's Scott Jordan telling you how to get your cannabis business financed. If you want to catch the rest of that interview, it's available up on my YouTube page, youtube.com/radicalruss, as are all the highlights of the Cannabis Business Conference. We got more of them coming up when we return. Stay tuned for Edgar Winters, Oregon's first licensed hemp farmer, and a couple of dispensary owners from California telling you how it's all done.
420 Radio is 24-hour marijuana legalization radio. 420 Radio. Tune in, turn on, get hot.
Despite strong public support for medical cannabis, decriminalization, and legalization in Georgia, the state spends $121 million every year to arrest, prosecute, and imprison Georgians for simple possession. Each year, the state of Georgia spends less on driver services, agriculture, and forestry combined. What else can $121 million a year do in Georgia? With that much money, the state could hire and keep 3,000 more teachers, improve roads and bridges, provide tax relief for small businesses, repair aging sewage systems, or lower taxes. But right now, that's millions of dollars of your tax money wasted on failed enforcement. Tell your representative you're tired of wasteful spending and ask them to end the cannabis prohibition. Join the conversation at www.peachtreenormal.org. Peachtree Normal is a proud affiliate of Normal, the national organization for the reform of marijuana laws.
Are you in the market for portable vaporizers now? Get online to vapes.buzz, the quick and easy link to portablevaporizersnow.com. Vapes.buzz has everything you are looking for, including vape pens, herbal vaporizers, e-juice, parts, accessories, and more. Visit vapes.buzz and use promo code 420radio to get 10% off your online purchase, or just give them a call at 866-264-2415. Vapes.buzz. Get vaping, baby!
Everyone knows music and marijuana go together, so let's wind up our 20 after break with the Russ Belville Show's Daily Toker Tunes, the best in pod safe 420 music from around the web. Today is Irie Wednesday, featuring reggae, ska, and other world music genres. Now, sit back and enjoy your Daily Toker Tunes.
Welcome back, everyone. Almost 23 after the hour, and I really, really wanted to have some Rocker T music for you today for Irie Wednesday. Rocker T was one of the performers at the after party of the International Cannabis Business Conference, and every time I set up to get some recording of him, he was going about, a minute or so into it, and then a fuse would blow out and kill all the music. So it happened once, and then I said, all right, well, I'll mingle about the party and catch him later. And so the next time I set up to catch some more, wouldn't you know it, fuse blew out again. So unfortunately, I have no clips of Rocker T to share with you, but I do have a clip here of the headlining performer, Del the Funky Homo Sapien, one of my favorite rap artists out there. I know that's more of a Groovin' Thursday tune, but we were going to just jump the gun a little bit because we are covering the International Cannabis Business Conference. So here's a look at the party. Enjoy with a little Del the Funky Homo Sapien.
Radio station. The law offices of Omar Figueroa would like to remind you to stand up for your rights. If you are detained or arrested, treat law enforcement with respect and stand up for your rights by repeating, "I respectfully invoke all of my legal and constitutional rights. I do not consent to any search and seizure. I want to remain silent, and I want to speak with my attorney." Please contact the law offices of Omar Figueroa at 415-489-0420 or 707-829-0215. Or on the web at omarfigueroa.com.
I like that.
Well, I don't know what you came to do, but what we came to keep the funk alive.
That's right, baby. We're keeping the funk alive right here at Big Daddy Fink's Funky Roller Rink, your groovy home of soul, funk, and disco. So join me, Big Daddy, every Thursday night, 11 Eastern, 8 Pacific, at the Funky Roller Rink, where every night is Saturday night.
Growing plants indoors can be a rewarding hobby, but electricity bills can go through the roof. Then you have to cool down all those big hot lights. It can drive a grower insane. With Lush LED lighting, you can solve many of these issues and double your rewards. Matt and his scientists have developed the perfect light for flowering plants with far less cost and heat. And the results?
very effective.
Check out LeshLEDLighting.com right now and tell them Radical Russ sent you. San Francisco to meet a fellow Oregonian. This is Edgar Winters, and he is Oregon's first licensed industrial hemp farmer. How does it feel?
It feels pretty good. It really does.
I just covered this story a second ago, yesterday's show, I think it was, and the big part of the story was that you're licensed to grow hemp, but there's nowhere to get seed. Tell us about trying to get some hemp seed to plant.
Well, it's been really kind of difficult because Canada was going to supply us with seed stock.
Cultivation ordinances and such things. from the 3 years that I worked in that dispensary in Clear Lake. After 3 years of working in Clear Lake, I got an opportunity to open up another dispensary with another group in Santa Rosa called the Snow Patient Group. At that time, I left the Compassion Center in Lake County and started Snow Patient Group with a couple of new partners, and we got a license. The city had just recently passed an ordinance where you could get a dispensary permit in Santa Rosa. They issued two permits. And the group that I work with got one of those very first permits, and we've had it ever since. And it was a lot different process than when you do the unregulated process. It's certainly a lot more of a comfortable feeling when you know that it's regulated, you know what the expectations are, and you know what it is that you're supposed to do. The drawback to the regulation that we had in Santa Rosa was it was very restrictive. Several years later, come forward, a lot of places in California have regulated medical marijuana dispensaries, cities and counties. Santa Rosa had the most restrictive that I've ever heard of or read about in Santa Rosa or in California or anywhere else for that matter. Our hands were tied with a lot of things that we didn't like about patient limits, what days you could be open, what days you had to be closed, what hours you had to be open, and that sort of thing. And so it took working within the confines of that regulation to try and get it changed. But we had a regulation. We didn't say, well, this doesn't work for us, we're not going to do it. We take what we can get, we take what we fight for, and we try to change it. And that's where we're at now in California. We're not the leader in the industry anymore. We will be, again, the leader in this industry if we can ever get our act together and come up with some really good regulation. So we heard a lot of good speakers earlier today and yesterday talking about regulations. It seems like regulations is on everybody's mind. And I can tell you that through my experience, the better regulated it is, the better and more successful you're going to be. But you don't have to stand still for regulations that you don't like. Get them passed, keep working with it, what we've got, and move on and make the regulations better. And the more you do that, the more successful that you're going to be. You want to be more successful than other people. Another thing that you have to keep in mind is customer service. Customer service and reaching out to your customers is something that's extremely important. I really like a lot of what Amber had to say in the last panel because she hit the nail on the head about the way we do things today, the way we advertise, and the way we have to adapt. This industry is a business industry like any other industry. So make no bones about it that we have to do the same things and find new and more interesting ways and cutting edge ways to take our message out to the people and get it to them and to take the feedback that they're able to give us today with today's social media and listen to what they have to say and give them what they need. Because if you don't, you won't be successful. So the things I really want you to take away from this conference and from the panel today, at least for me, is being regulatory compliant and fighting and moving forward, being a part of that process. Not sitting back and waiting, somebody else is going to get this done. Now, I wasn't the only person that worked on these regulations in Santa Rosa. One of the key players in this thing was one of my fellow panelists, Robert Jacob. He was the mayor of Sebastopol, like they said. And even before he was the mayor, he was really one of the persons spearheading this thing to change these regulations in Santa Rosa. Even though he didn't have a dispensary in Santa Rosa at the time. He was working in Sebastopol. Maybe he knew he was coming, maybe he wasn't. But he did, I think, because he believed it was the right thing to do. They weren't great regulation. It was workable, but nobody was going to be super prosperous and you weren't going to be able to help as many people as you really wanted to help, especially in a city like that. So sitting back and waiting for other people to do this isn't really the answer. We've got to get involved and we've got to do it. And that's what I've done since I started doing this, is making sure that we're moving forward through proper regulation and doing something about it.
For you, Dave. Are the mics on, by the way? Some people back there? Okay. Dave, so we're doing SWOT analysis. We'll start with strengths. Just a question about the dispensary industry. What do you think is the biggest strength that we have as an industry together?
I think the biggest strength is right now we get to create and decide how it's going to move forward. You know, we don't have to sit and buy and be bystanders. We actually have the ability. We're the ones in contact with the people. We're the ones who get the signatures on the ballots. If that's what we need to do to change the rules and regulations, I think the biggest strength is that we can get the people behind us.
That's amazing. Thank you. Our next speaker, Rick Frommer. Do you want to come up, Rick?
Sure.
Rick is with Harborside Health Center. He's done a heck of a lot for the movement. He's kind of one of the unsung heroes that maybe you don't hear about all the time, but he's been laboring nonstop for all of us for, getting on 30 years almost. Take it away. Sorry.
That's going to make me all of us older and older. Thank you, Dave. The sign down to. From pot to SWOT. 3 years ago, I had no idea what SWOT analysis was, other than maybe trying to get rid of a fly or something. And we started doing it at Harborside and started looking at our strengths and weaknesses and opportunities and threats. And We continue to do that to this day, and they're an essential part of, as Debbie was saying, the process of really honestly analyzing your business, as it increasingly is becoming a real mainstream businesses. I think one of the things that makes California different, the dispensary scene different in California than anywhere else is, well, for one, we've been doing this for close to 20 years already. Even though we don't have statewide regulations, some of our local civic regulations are amongst the best in the nation and are certainly less burdensome than the supposedly legal situations that we see in some other states. One of the most important things I see in the dispensary world in California coming up is, you know, how we maintain our heart and soul. And before that 20 years, we were doing it legally here in California. We were doing it for another 20 years underground. So California, unlike any other place, has got close to a 40-year infrastructure of cannabis production, consumption, distribution, et cetera, et cetera. There's thousands of heritage farmers from up and down the state who are multi-generational at this point, whose entire livelihood, as well as the livelihood of all those small towns that they live in, completely depends on cannabis. So I think one of the big challenges for the dispensaries is, you know, how do we continue to form partnerships with these people? How do we represent them in the legislative process that's happening as we talk in Sacramento? How do they get represented during the initiative process? It's very easy to talk about coming in as they did in other states, and I really don't need to pick on. I have infinite respect for Colorado and Washington for being first. Should have been us, but they beat us to the punch. But, you know, building 600, 800 light grows and using that kind of electrical draw in order to provide cannabis when you have abundant sunshine. Unfortunately, Colorado, you are seeing shifting to greenhouse production finally to some extent, but there's still literally, you know, multi-hundred lighters being set up there on a basis. They also wrote their law to limit outside investment, to not make anybody from another state a principal. Basically meaning they were allowed to build up a monopoly over the last couple of years. And those folks are strongly moving into California at this point. There's deals on the table that they're already doing. There's other ones being talked about. And certainly, you know, this is America. We all have a right to do business and to do the things. But we've already built a really good model for dispensaries here. It wasn't in California that you heard about people overdosing on edibles or edibles being mislabeled. You don't hear a lot of, you know, we've certainly had some issues with the VHO hash production. And so in a more regulated model, that can also be safely produced. But, you know, I see the biggest threat, if we're doing the SWOT analysis at this point, of the medical cannabis industry in California is, you know, how do we maintain that heart and soul? There's a fantastic documentary that I just got to see the other day. It was about Dennis Barone's first. Everybody put their hands up in the audience and knows who Dennis Barone is. That's pretty good. It should have been every hand in the room, but that's pretty good. There's a piece that this guy did about 10 years ago called The First U.S. Pot Club. That's all about Dennis Barone's Market Street Club. That for any of you that had a chance to experience it, was a beautiful moment in time. They had two different floors.
Sir, do you think there will or should come a time for us to discuss the possibility of legalization, regulation, and control of all drugs, thereby doing away with the violent criminal market as well as a major source of funding for international terrorism? Thank you so much for your time, Mr. President.
Well, I think this is an entirely legitimate topic for debate.
Name the time and place, Mr. President. Radical Russ has been prepping for this debate full-time since 2005. The Russ Belville Show.
.420 Radio, the home of marijuana experts. At Herbie's Cannabis Seeds, we pride ourselves on bringing you the best quality seeds from the world's most respected cannabis seed producers, all at the lowest online prices. You can find Herbie's Seeds at herbiesheadshop.com. All cannabis seeds are sold as souvenirs and as a means of preserving cannabis genetics. Herbie's Seeds in no way intends to condone, promote, or incite the use of illegal or controlled substances. We strongly urge all prospective customers to check their national laws prior to placing an order. Herbie's Seeds at herbiesheadshop.com. Proud sponsors of the Russ Belville Show and 420 Radio.
There's so much I worry about as a mom. Stephen Harper thinks that organized crime should continue to profit from marijuana prohibition. Imagine regulating marijuana like alcohol and cigarettes with a strong and clear educational message, making it more difficult for my kids and your kids to access. Drug dealers don't ask for ID. Stephen Harper does not have the kind of judgment we need to protect our children, authorized by the Normal Women's Alliance of Canada.
Adam Hand of Handmade Apparel produces quality custom designs for t-shirts, hats, and other apparel. Handmade Apparel is the official design shop for 420 Radio, among many clients who rely on Adam Hand for everything from short-run custom projects to full-run clothing lines. Visit handmadeapparel.biz to browse the selection of handmade gear or to get a personal quote for your own designs. Handmade Apparel, a proud supporter of 420radio.org.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, Dean Becker from Law Enforcement Against Prohibition with the 40-second spiel.
All right, folks, pretend for 1 second you're the drug czar of these United States. I have a question for you. The drug war empowers our terrorist enemies if they'll just dare to grow these flowers we forbid. It enriches these barbarous cartels south of our border, killing tens of thousands, mostly innocents, each year, and it has given reason for existence to more than 30,000 violent gangs that prowl our neighborhoods with high-powered weapons. So I must ask you, sir, considering that this drug war has never stopped even one determined child from getting their hands on drugs, what is the benefit? What do we derive from this policy that even begins to offset the horror we inflict on ourselves by continuing to believe? It is my observation that those who believe in drug war quite obviously do not believe in public safety. Your answer, sir, what is the benefit?
Conference?
Second conference.
What was the first?
The Portland conference.
down for a distribution model that doesn't exist in the market today. To really find the outlet. So these really good growers, people that have great equipment, they can get their products distributed across different states, hundreds of stores, at a low cost per store.
That's fantastic. If people want more info, what's the online contact?
Cannabis Online Marketing Platform.com. We have a contact form. Feel free to visit our site and send us a note. We'll be happy to follow up and talk about your needs.
All right, thank you so much.
All right.
Consume sugar and things like that. And it addition to that, we also have our Stokes Confections. We have our sugar-free micros that are here. These are micro-dosed. We wanted patients to be able to customize their dose. So each one of these only has 5 milligrams of THC in them. And you would get a bottle that has either 20 or 50 pills in there. And so you could customize the amount that you need. Then we also have our truffles. These are absolutely delicious. I wish they weren't medicated so that I could eat like 20 of them while watching a movie. And everything is made in-house. We are not one of those companies that just buys confections and then coats it in oil and then tries to sell it. Everything is made from scratch. We have dark chocolate, truffles with a raspberry.
Some edibles.
Exactly.
And, you know, tripping and
hallucinating, yeah, or they're medicated for 3 days.
Makes it a bad experience that kind of passes off to other people that are inexperienced.
Exactly.
So tell people how they can find out more about your company and to learn if they want to distribute these items.
Yeah, so Stokes Confections, you can go to getstokes.com. Yeah, check us out. You can send us an email and we'll come to your dispensary if you're in California. Hopefully other states soon.
So that's our coverage of the International Cannabis Business Conference that took place on Sunday and Monday. And, of course, the Oregon Medical Marijuana Business Conference will be taking place soon. You can catch that.
Radio, fighting prohibition.
Sorry, let's get the right thing to play here. So much fun with the Liebermeter when we come back from break. But that's all the time we got for today. Time flies when you legalize. Remember, the Oregon Medical Marijuana Business Conference take place March 15th and 16th in Eugene at the Hilton. And Governor Gary Johnson and Harborside Steve D'Angelo will be delivering the keynote addresses. We, of course, will be covering it and bringing you highlights here on the Russ Belville Show. Thanks for joining us for today's 2 hours. We'll give you another 2 hours tomorrow, starting at 3 p.m. Pacific time, right here on 420radio.org and other fine associated websites. I'm Radical Russ. Thanks for joining us. And until next time, take care of each other, Tokers.
This is the Russ Belville Show. The Russ Belville Show is blogging and podcasting daily at RadicalRuss.com. You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you dry it, you roll it, you smoke it. You take a seed, you plant it.